We are looking at equalizers and decision feedback equalization in particular, and we saw that the critical timing path in the decision feedback equalizer is closing the first tap, okay, because the latch will take some time to resolve the small amplitude input to the logic level, and the feedback path, which is essentially an amplifier, will have some delay depending on its bandwidth, and this bandwidth is constrained because in a decision feedback equalizer you have a large number of taps summing at the same node, increasing the parasitic capacitance. Okay, so that delay has to be within half a cycle, or certainly not well within one cycle. All right, so that is difficult to achieve. For further taps, it's okay because the second tap has to come 1.5 cycles later if you want the eye diagrams to be exactly coincident, and the third one 2.5 cycles later. So that is okay, 1.5 cycles later somehow it will come, you will have enough delay and then that is fine, but the first one is the most difficult. And there is a particular method used to resolve this, and this is a problem whether you implement this either in analog or in digital. Even in digital, basically you have to decide on something and then feedback that decision to the summing point, and the sum has to be generated within one cycle. Okay, so I think, as you know, digital circuit speed is also constrained by such loops, right? So the same thing happens when you implement the entire equalization in the digital domain. Basically, the constraint is, I will show a one tap DFE for simplicity. Now, this will have some clock to queue delay. The clock to queue delay of a flip flop is not fixed, okay. It depends on the input amplitude. If the input amplitude is small, it takes a long time to regenerate. This is why it is important to have as large an amplitude as possible at the input of a flip flop. Clock to queue delay plus, I will just call this this path delay, right? That is through this. Whatever, usually this is a differential pair and then you have a summing node, depending on the bandwidth you will have some delay. Should be about half the clock period. We have 0.6 t naught, it is probably okay, but it is not okay to have t naught, right, because then the edges of the feedback will fall in the middle of the next symbol and it will completely close the eye. Basically, you need an open eye at the sampling instant at the input of the decision flip flop. Okay. So, this is a problem, this is a constraint in a given process. As the process technology increases, obviously, these delays will become smaller. So, the frequency at which you can implement the DFE in the straightforward way increases, okay, but there will be some point it will break down. So, what might be a solution to this? So, let us say I call this y, okay, and let us say the decision is perfect, it will just find the sign of whatever that is, okay. So, at this point I will have a perfect decision at the output of the flip flop. So, what are the possible values at the input of the flip flop? What possible values will I see? I mean, what are the choices? The C naught is the first tap, okay, that is the. So, if your channel, the first ISI, this one corresponds to C naught. normalized to some voltage, then if you subtract it off, there is no ISR. So that is that C0. Okay. So what are the values that I'll see after the summation? V0, what is V0? I mean, assume that these values are called just like plus minus 1, okay. So, or maybe I should not call the C0, sorry, I think I used to call the C1, right? So, that is the first term. Okay. So, what will I see? Why? It is correct, it is plus or minus what? It is just Y plus or minus C1, okay. So, it is based on this that I will make the decision. So, the way to ease this timing constraint is by the way, when we do this in the analog domain, everything is a voltage, okay. And I pointed out that the error slicers have this offset of plus minus V naught, okay. Plus minus V naught correspond to 1. So, all the other tabs have to be scaled with V naught, okay. Here I do not want to complicate the notation. I am assuming that Y has the appropriate amplitude so that its values are plus and minus 1, and then the C 1, which is the tap value, is what you feed back. If Y has values of plus minus V naught, the feedback voltage has to be C 1 times V naught, okay. So, what I do is I calculate both Y. So, if the symbol is a 1, the input of the flip flop would be Y minus C naught, right, because the ISI will be positive and I will subtract off the ISI. And if the symbol is a minus 1, I would have got Y plus C naught. So, this is Y minus C naught, this is Y plus C naught, okay. C1 again. Thanks. Yeah, this makes more sense because it is the first term. So, one of these is the correct one. So, what I do is I make a decision on both of them, okay. So, I have two flip flops instead of one. Okay. So, one of these is the correct one. So, how do I pick, how do I know which is the correct one? So, I have to pick one of these things. Okay. Yeah. So, now again, as with the decision feedback equalizer, I would assume that I have the right decision at some point. Then the control signals of the MUX. So, let us say the MUX has a control signal, right, to pick which one it is. That has to come from the previous decision. Okay. So, if the previous decision is a 1, you pick the upper one. If the previous decision is a 0, you pick the lower one, okay. Is this fine? Is this okay? So, I know that in a binary, with binary data transmission, the feedback of the first tap has two possible values, either plus the tap value or minus the tap value. So, I compute both in parallel and make a decision on both of them. One of these decisions is correct, and which one is correct depends on the previous decision. So, I pick the right one based on the previous decision, okay. So, is this actually solving the problem? I mean, is it better? Why is it better? Yeah, this Z inverse doesn't mean that you should have like a full cycle delay here. Basically, this the control here has to reach the control from the previous decision. The previous decision has to reach the control. Okay. Now here also there is a feedback loop. Okay, but the difference is that in this case the D flip flop, which makes a decision from a small amplitude signal that is within the feedback loop. So, its delay is large compared to the same D flip flop, right. If you apply a large amplitude input signal, you will have a small delay compared to when you have a small amplitude input signal. Okay. So, it just takes, you can do this experiment. So, if you apply like small amplitudes, okay, it will take a long time to regenerate. Okay. If you apply a large amplitude, it will regenerate more quickly, and what I am showing are roughly the output voltages of a D flip flop starting from small and large amplitudes. Okay. So, the D flip flop's delay is going to be large if the amplitude is small, and like I said, this path here, right, it adds to the summing point. So, many other paths also add to the summing point, other traps of the DFE. So, this is a low bandwidth node. Whereas, here if you look at the feedback loop, all it is doing is these are already full amplitude regenerated signals. You have to pick one of them, okay, based on some control signal. So, you have two switches, you have full amplitude signal. This delay is going to be a lot smaller than the delay here, and also you, the summing tap is over there, right. Not, there is no big summing tap here giving you a small bandwidth. Okay. So, so, you have only a mux, not a decision flip flop within the feedback path. Okay. So, here also you have a feedback path, but the feedback path is to only select between two full amplitude digital values, whereas earlier the feedback path contained within that decision flip flop and relatively low bandwidth summing path. Okay. So, this definitely makes things easier, and this is also used by the way in digital. I think first in fact proposed by someone known as Sanjay Kasturia. This guy was in Stanford, and then he proposed it for some digital equalization. Okay. And this is known as speculative decision feedback equalization. Basically, you speculate on the decision, you make all of them, and then you pick the right one. Yeah. So, what do you think? So, let us say you had to do this for two paths, what will you have to do? So, let us say, I mean, in the process that you have the first two taps also you could not close the timing. So, how will this look like? What will this picture look like? So, now I have one decision flip flop in the earlier case. In this case, I have two. So, what will happen if I need more taps? 4 taps. Basically, if I need to do it for n taps, I have C1, C2, right. So, I have minus C1, minus C2, minus C1 plus C2, plus C1 minus C2, and plus C1 plus C2. I have to compute all of them. There are 4 possible paths. And if you want to do it for n taps, you will be have, you will have 2 to the n paths. So, it quickly becomes quite unwieldy. Okay. Again, it is not necessary. It is not necessary in the sense at some point it becomes unnecessary, because clearly, for the first tap you had half a cycle, for the second tap you had 1.5 cycles. So if you have 1.5 cycles available, then you implement the speculative DFE only for the first app, and after that you have the straight one. And that's typically the case in the modern processes. If you look at, let's say, 10 gigabits per second and 65 nanometers, you can probably do the basic DFE, that is this DFE, right, the straightforward one. The point is, actually, many times, I mean, you can do this, but to get these delays to be small, you may end up burning more power. So that is another thing to be evaluated. It's not just whether it's possible or not. It may be possible. So what happens typically is, as you try to reduce the delays beyond a certain point, you will have to burn more and more power. Okay, I think I mentioned this earlier also. If you have, let's say, a digital circuit, you want to clock it faster and faster. So from low frequencies, if you look at it, the power dissipation will increase linearly with frequency. And at some point, as you approach the sort of capabilities of technology, the power dissipation increases more sharply. And at some point, it's not doable at all. Okay, so that's what happens. So this, you have to actually sit and design it and evaluate the power advantage. But typically, you need it only for the first app, because the next app you have more relaxed timing constraint and you can implement that straightforwardly. Okay. So what will happen is that you will have, for the higher taps, you will have the usual summation here. Okay. Let us say this is C2 and so on. Okay. And that comes straight from the decision. So you may have some other delay. So when I show these delays, again, do not think of it as full cycle delays implemented with the flip flop, because here we are talking about very high speeds. The parasitic delays are also comparable. So basically, you need to have the total delay in the path has to be this much. At low frequencies, if you say one cycle delay, you will just put a flip flop, right? That's a, you go on putting flip flops and then you will get delays. But at high frequencies, you also have to look at the clock to queue delay and those things. And this is particularly important when you have things in feedback. When you have open loop stuff, right? So this clock to queue delay only means that in ideally you would have got it at some point. Now everything is delayed by that much. That may or may not be a big deal. But when you have closed loop stuff, then I mean, you know that delay in a closed loop stuff is, I mean, it can make it unstable or it doesn't work properly. Okay. Any questions? Now you can also see that we have been only talking about binary data transmission for simplicity, because many of the serial link stuff, right, lot of the things are in a matter of detail. Okay, like if I sit and write everything formally, it just takes a long time to explain and you won't get the hang of things. So that's why I've been trying to do it with binary stuff. You can extend everything to, let's say, PAM4 case. At very high speeds, you won't use like many, I mean, higher levels anyhow. So then what will happen if you have PAM4? That is, PAM4 means you have 4 levels basically, let us say -3, -1, +1, +3, 4 logic level. Okay. So what will the speculative DFE look like? First of all, here, I mean, even in the regular DFE, this is not just a single flip flop, right? You will have multiple flip flops to distinguish between the 4 levels. So at this point, you will have 4 possible levels. Okay. So in the speculative DFE, again, you will have, you have to add 4 possible values to Y, because the previous symbol could have had 4 values. So the intersymbol interference from that can also have 4 possible values. Okay, C1 times +3, +1, -1, or -3. So it will just like quickly become bigger. The tree becomes bigger. Okay. Any questions? So what else could we do to optimize the power consumption? I mean, earlier also in case of the CDR, we thought of these things, right? what did we, what other options did we explore in the CDR when we had multiple latches and then you have to have high frequency clocks and so on. There are other architectures that we explored, right? What was it? Let's just take the bang-bang CDR to make life a little bit easier for the latch and so on, for the waveforms to settle, etc. What did we do? No, that's okay. I mean, that's how we implemented anyhow, right? Like if you want a flip flop, you will just put two latches. No, that's not what I'm talking about. Let's say you have 25 gigabits per second and you want to make a clock and data recovery circuit. You have to run this 25 gigabits per second clock all over the place. All the flip flops have to settle within some period. Yeah, half rate, that's the crucial thing. So, that's the, so we just tried to do everything with half rate clocks. Of course, it's not the same as running the entire circuit at half the rate, because the input data symbol period is still exactly the same, okay. So, the timing margins are the same, but first of all the clocks that you distribute are at lower frequencies. So, again like I said, if you are operating in a region where you have linear dependence with frequency, these things may or may not have an advantage. But when you are operating at the edge of the technology, increasing the clock rate by factor of 2 could make you increase the power dissipation by a much bigger factor, okay. So, one is clock distribution itself, okay. You will have to distribute more clock phases when you go to half rate, right. When we are in the half rate CDR, we had not only clock, we also had 90 degrees, or if you have differential clocks in the full rate stuff, you have 0 and 180 degrees. In the half rate stuff, you have 0, 180, 90 and 270, okay. But it may still be advantageous to do that, and it will allow more time for settling, okay. The sampling aperture and so on will be the same, that is the you still have to sample the input within some given window, but then you can have the waveforms can settle better. So, similarly could we make the first, let us take this DFE, could we make this with half rate clocks, how do we do that? What do we need actually, if we have a half rate clock instead of full rate clocks? Parallel path. Now, let us say I am not interested in recombining, it could be that say in the half rate case you will typically have two paths and the alternate bits will be here and there. Anyway, I am going to deserialize, that is okay. So, but the important thing is first of all I need two parallel paths, right, one operating on the positive edge of the clock, the other on the negative edge of the clock. So, No. This C1, right, that still refers to the symbol, the period that is being transmitted, okay. So, if you have 10 gigabits per second data, C1 refers to inter-symbol interference from 100 picoseconds later, okay. So, and C2 from 200 picoseconds later, those are the interfering bits, right. So, however we interpret, I mean however we realize the receiver. So, C1 still refers to one symbol later. So, that is why we will see like how to implement that. So, first of all I will need two decision blocks, because I mean each decision is, each flip flop can only make half the decisions now, because it is running at half the rate. So, I will need two of them, okay. I will say call them both the same clock, and I will show that the bottom one is a negative edge trigger clock, the upper one is a positive edge trigger clock. In principle, in at these frequencies most of these things are, I mean many times you have differential clocks in which you just swap the wires and move on, okay. Or you may have single phase clocks in which you need to have both clock and clock bar going to the same kind of flip-flop. Okay, you typically use the same kind of flip-flop. You don't invert all the polarities of transistors to make a negative edge triggered flip-flop. You use the same flip-flop, but reverse the clock phase that you are driving it with, okay, because you want the circuits to behave the same, otherwise the asymmetry will be just too much. So, these two make decisions, and this Y here should receive or what should be subtracted from this Y? Yeah, you need to basically subtract C1 times the previous symbol. Okay. So, that is the same in both cases. Okay. Now, these two are alternate decisions. One gives you even bits, one gives you odd bits. That is okay. Anyway, I mean, first of all, in any even if I had full rate stuff, I would have followed this by a deserializer, which means I will divide into odd even and then further this one. So, this already has done that part of the job. That is one of the reasons why this half rate is not such a loss. I mean, it is not as though you have to recombine this. Okay. Anyway, you are going down this path, I mean, you would have this multiple flip flops. So, that is why this half rate architectures can be advantageous. So, then how do you get these feedback terms for this and that? Basically, if you think about it, this should get the decision previous to whatever is being decided now, and that comes from here. Okay. I'll show this one. And then similarly, this goes there. Okay. And now, if you plot the eye diagrams at different points, it will look quite exotic, because why? This has a period, I mean a symbol period equal to T naught, and what is being added here has a period of 2 T naught. Okay. So, it will look weird in that it will have a periodicity of 2 T naught, one half of it will be total garbage, the other half will make sense. Okay. So, the complete serial link stuff can look quite complex. So, but I have explained piecewise, but you have to realize that this has to work together with the CDR and so on, right. So, everything has to work properly, and it does work. One good thing is the CDR itself is typically able to lock with a much higher, much lower quality of I than the actual decisions. For I mean, in a serial link, you may want the decisions to have a bitter rate of 10 to the minus 12 or even lesser, 10 to the minus 15, but a CDR will work properly well before. I mean, at the bitter rates much higher than that, 10 to the minus 3 or something like that. Okay. Is this okay? So, this is now half rate DFE. So, the clocks are half rate and you will get even and odd bits here. Okay. Now, what is the next step? I mean, if this also can have timing difficulties, right, because you do have this feedback path. Okay. So, that still has to be completed in half a cycle, even though you are making a decision. I mean, this has to appear here by the time the next symbol appears from Y. Okay. So, in that respect, the delay constraints are the same as the first case. So, what is the next logical step now? So, this is actually not making the DFE decision loop, DFE feedback loop implementation easier. This is for something else. This is so that your clocks are running at half rate and you have more time to settle and so on. Now, if you also have difficulty with DFE feedback loop timing, what is the thing to do? Yeah, you have to do speculative and half rate. So, which means that you will need So this is the speculative stuff for the even decisions. This is the speculative stuff for odd decisions. Okay. So, how do you do the selection now? Sorry, I mean, there is no summation here. The whole point is not to do the selection. Then what? So basically, this mux has to be selected based on this, and this one has to be selected based on that. Okay. So I mean, I think I made a. There is summation, but not driven by feedback. So. So, the summation is not within feedback and the decision is not within the feedback, that is the whole idea, and you get the even and odd stuff here. This is half rate, one tap, speculative DFE. Okay. Now, of course, you typically do not have only one tap, you have multiple DFE taps. The rest of it typically can be closed in the conventional way. Because the timing constraint for them is not as severe. But in principle, you can speculate as many taps as you want. It is just that if you speculate over n taps, you will need 2 to the n parallel paths. And then you have to choose one of them based on the decision. Okay. Any questions about this? So, were you able to do all the problems in the assignment? This one, the previous assignment? You are able to use LDO to get the phase noise? Are you able to use LDO to get the phase noise? Okay. Any questions about the assignment? Any? No, I mean the peak value of the oscillation peak is about 0.7 volt. Yeah. Okay, I mean if it is not, if it is somewhat different and you got the result, just let it be reported. Which diode? No, no, I mean I think I asked for just using a varactor diode, right? Yeah, yeah, I know. So, but the transistor is off, and so if you look at a, let's say, was it a PMOS or NMOS? So, if I remember correctly, this is what I get. This is NVL. This is P, and the way you make a PMOS is like this. But I think the configuration I had suggested is the MOS transistor part is off and you are using this diode, this P plus N diode, okay, the junction diode. This is because, I mean, these days actually the kind of varactor that is used is like you mentioned, it is N minus, but then inside that you put N plus, okay, and have a gate. So, this is one terminal, this is the other terminal. And if you look at this, if you look at the NMOS characteristic, you know that the CV characteristics, it looks like that, right. So, this is accumulation, this is depletion and this is inversion. Now, in this case, this is not a MOS transistor, this is NMOS inside an NML, okay. So, in this case, I think you will have only like one sided characteristic like that, okay. So, this is the varactor that is used, but in that process, I mean, this is a special device that has to be modeled and they have to give you the model. If you use the PMOS device, you will get some characteristic like this. There is non-monotonic stuff, it is not clear what it will do as you vary the frequency. So, that is why I said just use this, okay. I did not have time to experiment with it too much because I had to travel, but does it vary the frequency? It does, right? Huh. Was it connected like this or? So, was not it connected like this? This is the control and these are the swings, right? Okay. Oh, it is given the other way in the assignment. Oh. Oh, okay. So, then I made a mistake in the schematic. No, no, no. One second. So, was it this was with the inductor connected to VDD, right? Okay. And then this is control voltage. Is this how it is in the assignment or the other way around? The diodes are reversed, is it? Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah, if it is reversed, for sure it does not work because this is VDD, right? This is biased at VDD and this goes from 0 to VDD. So, this is the correct one. Sorry about that. I did not realize that it was wrong. But I thought I checked it, but anyway. Yeah, in practice, I mean, you have to look at the breakdown. The there will be some breakdown voltages for every junction. Now, in a MOS transistor, the most fragile part is the oxide as far as I know. So, when you say 1.2 volt transistor or some supply voltage limited transistor, it is the gate source voltage or the gate channel voltage of the transistor that is on that is limited. So, let us say you have 65 nanometers with 1.2 volt supply, there is usually a 10% margin, 1.32 volts. So, you should not have the voltage between this and that, the gate and this to be 1.2 volts or more, okay. The drain source voltage could possibly a little more and that also depends on whether the transistor is on or off. Similarly, the gate bulk voltage could be more if the transistor is off. These junction breakdown voltages are higher, I mean not indefinitely, but higher than the supply voltage that you have. So, yeah, this is a concern. I mean, of course, when you make a reliable design, you have to look into all these things. At the same time, I think there is no point being like overly conservative with everything also, because I also used to think that you cannot have any terminal voltages to be more than 1.2 volts, but that is not the case. I mean, and also what happens with these things is that it is not as though the moment you apply 1.21 volts, the transistor explodes or something. I mean, over time, its VT changes and it degrades. It is of course, important in a product for it to be reliable, because if enough transistors misbehave like this, you may have a failed product, right. But it can take some stress, but some of these things are, I mean, it is certainly not something I am familiar with, because I think these things also depend on whether you apply a DC and hold it for a long time or whether you apply a time varying voltage, because somehow the time varying voltage has a much smaller effect than this, okay. Even if you consider the average, let us say you apply 1 volt for some time versus 2 volt sinusoid for some time, it is not the same effect. Yeah. Yeah, so that is like so let's say this is the RLC, this is the LC tank with loss GP, and this is compensated by a transconductor in positive feedback, its value is GN. Okay, so this gives a negative resistance of minus GN, and let's say GN is like this, the characteristic of GN, that is if you plot I versus V, it has a slope GN, okay, and then it saturates to some plus minus I naught. Now if this GN is smaller than GP, it won't even start, or even if you have an initial condition, it just dies out. If GN equals GP, what happens is it can oscillate with any amplitude smaller than this. Okay? If GN is more than GP, then what happens is that the oscillation amplitude will be something like this. It will be more than this corner voltage. So, in this part of the cycle, there is positive loss, it is losing energy, and in the rest of the cycle, more energy is being put from GN than is being dissipated in GP. So, finally, where it balances out, energy is balanced. Okay? So, that is how it is. Now, if you look at just the total small signal conductance, what happens is that if you plot it versus V. So, you can see that between these two points you actually have, or if I basically let me do it the other way, I look at the loss conductance due to GP is just this, and the loss conductance due to GN, there is some negative loss, so it will be like that, and then after that the incremental GN is just 0, right. And if you sum these two, what you will see is that there is some negative loss here and then some positive loss over there. Okay. So, it does not stop here, but it stops where the energy is balanced. Okay. And if you assume, I mean for this particular case, this you would have I am sure seen the solution. So, you can go on increasing GN, that is with the same I naught, okay. You can make it sharper and sharper. And let us say you just make it a current switch. Okay? So, for that basically you have infinite negative resistance, negative conductance here and 0 there. For that you can easily show that the amplitude here will be 4 I naught R p by pi. Okay? Basically if the Q is high, we can do that in some class if necessary, this is also done in the undergrad class if you want to look at the lectures. So, this current will be a square wave current. And if you assume that this is high Q, it will pick out only the fundamental. So, you know that the current is plus I naught minus I naught, and its fundamental component is slightly more than this peak, right. The peak value is 4 by pi I naught. This 4 by pi I naught at the resonance frequency flows only through this, because this cancels with that one. So, the amplitude is 4 I naught R p by pi. Okay? So, now, from this point, if you go on reducing the value of GN, okay, what happens is the amplitude slightly reduces below this, and when GN falls below GP, then it stops oscillation. Okay. So, that is how it is. So, you cannot actually look at the, you cannot gauge the amplitude from the small signal characteristics, you have to do the large signal calculation. Okay. Because small signal wise, it looks like the moment you have poles in the, I mean this is one of the ways you do calculate the amplitude, I mean if we do not know anything else, you linearize it, and then you look at the amplitude at which the linearized circuit has pulse in the left half plane, and at that point it stops, but that's not correct actually, okay, because then clearly this region is totally forbidden, but it does go into that region because it's being overcompensated in this region and undercompensated in the other region. So finally the energy balance has to be there. Yeah. But are you doing the RF class? If you do the RF class, probably it will be there in the VCO stuff, or we can do it in our class also. I mean, I didn't do it while dealing with VCOs, but yeah, this is quite easily shown.